Let me just say that I love the banner. Banner ladies. Banner group. You're all ladies, so we call you the banner ladies, but you're really a banner committee, right? I love the banner. I love what's central in that banner, because if we're going to amplify, that's who we're going to amplify in our voices and with our speech. Now, this I mentioned last week, if you're here last week for New Year's Sunday, I mentioned that we're going to be looking at our theme verse this week. Well, I've changed my mind. I'm entitled to do that from now and then, right? Change my mind about stuff. I know people in my house that change their mind a lot, so I'm allowed to change. I'm allowed to change my mind sometimes. We went over, Kathleen and I went over kind of our sermon series, our plan for the next number of weeks, right up until Easter. And as we kind of talked about what we're going to do, I decided we're going to wait on looking at this verse. We're going to look at it a little later. And certainly, like we did for our last theme verse, Ask, Seek, and Knock, we'll come back to it all the year through, right? We'll keep going back to this theme verse of John 3 and 30. I must decrease and he must increase. We'll look at that over and over this year, but we're not going to look at it this morning. Instead, over the next few weeks, what I wanted to do was kind of unpack or maybe even condense, actually, what we want to look at through this whole year with this theme of amplify. We want to look at the word amplify. We want to look at the word edify from that, edifying the church, building up the church. We want to look at the word magnify, magnifying God, magnifying the name of Jesus. And so, over the next few weeks, we'll look at those words closely. And throughout the year, we might have a sermon series on each of those words. But we want to just kind of run down what we're going to be talking about throughout this year with this theme. And this morning, I wanted to talk about the word itself, amplify. But amplifying our voices as God's church, as God's people, we want to speak up and speak out. We want to amplify our voices, our resolve, our message. It was a great children's time. Thank you, Allison, as they ran around and spread the word like we're supposed to. We're all called, all of us are called to speak up, to speak truth, to speak love, to speak hope, to speak forgiveness, to speak peace, to speak Christ. We're all called to that. There's familiar verses in 1 Peter 2 and 9, and we know this verse, a lot of us know this verse very well. You are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation. And I want to read the words to you from the Message translation. Most all the scripture I have for you this morning is from the Message. So is the scripture text from the Message paraphrase that Colonel Gwen read for me. Thank you, Colonel. Here is 1 Peter 2 and 9 from the Message. But you are the ones chosen by God, chosen for the high calling of priestly work, chosen to be a holy people, God's instrument to do his work and to speak out for him, to tell others of the night and day difference he's made for you, from nothing to something, from rejected to accepted. Isn't that beautiful? We have a story to tell. We have a message to share of what God has done in our lives, what God is doing in our lives, and we should share it. It's a beautiful thing. It's an important message. We live in a world where people are still feeling outcast. People are still feeling dejected. And they need a kind word. They need a loving word. And we need to be there to share it. We need to be the ones who embrace, who speak words of, that breathe life, who speak words that express welcome. We need to be those people. And as I reflected over what texts I wanted to use this morning, because I knew this was in my head, the theme, it's a thematic sermon, right? So I'm looking for a scripture to back that up. And not just pulling from everywhere. But as I kind of wandered through some different texts that I knew that spoke about speaking up. I came to this one in Psalm 119 that we heard from just a moment ago. And it's really, it captivated me. I'd never read it from the Message before, you see. And in the Message, it used the words, speak out, and that's what got my attention first, of course. But it's such a beautiful prayer that Colonel Gwen read for us. Psalm 119 is the longest chapter in the Bible, and it's poetic. It goes through all the alphabet, and it may have had multiple writers, but it's a beautiful, beautiful psalm, and that section of it really struck me as a beautiful prayer of commitment to God, a beautiful prayer calling for God to move in lives, and a commitment to speak out and to speak up. And it was read a moment ago, but to recap, let's look at some of the specific requests the psalmist prays for. His specific request, he says, God, teach me lessons for living. These are things we all should be praying for in our lives. God, teach me lessons for living. Give me insight. Guide me. Give me a bent, or give me a real raw determination. Divert my eyes. How important is that? From trivial things, from less important things, or from things that would lead me astray. Divert my eyes. Affirm your promises, he prays. Deflect the harsh words of my critics. Protect my spirit. Right? That's what I read. Let your love, God, shape my life with salvation. Let your love shape my life with salvation. Beautiful prayer. It's truly a prayer for right priorities that he's praying, that he's lifting up to God, for guidance, for teaching. The whole thing really seems to me to be a search for truth, a longing for real truth that this psalm writer is praying. And the next verse, I don't have it up there, but the next verse affirms that idea that he's longing for truth. When he says, don't deprive me of truth, not ever. Don't deprive me of truth, not ever, God. I want your truth. I long for your truth. And that plea is so important. If we're going to be a people who speak up, a people who speak out, if we're going to be the voices for those without a voice, if we are going to share good news, if we're going to share the love of God with others, then we need to understand the truth of God. Have a clear understanding of it. It's very dangerous to share when we don't. In the New Testament, one of the most common warnings through all the epistles, all the letters that people wrote to the early church, one of the most common warnings is beware of false teachings and beware of false teachers, because you'll be led astray. And it's damaging to our lives and our spirits and our minds even. We need to understand truth, to have a good grip of God's truth. One of the most important things when it comes to sharing is knowing truth. If we speak anything, we must speak truth. If we ever hope to give any sort of guidance to someone, then we need to be open to guidance. The blind can't lead the blind, and nor should they. It's been said before of how important it is to speak truth in love. I'm sure you've heard that phrase. We have to speak the truth, but speak in love. And that is true. You got to forgive me. My entire house has a cold. Okay, so I'm going to be sniffing, and you're going to hear it, because that's the way this mic works. For the future record, whoever uses this mic next, you might want to give it a good cleaning. We have to speak the truth in love. It reminds me of Alex when he was little. We were at home visiting my parents, and he had met my grandmother before. Jessie is her name. We call her Great Nanny Jessie. He met her before, but he was too young to remember, really, right? And we were home visiting, and we had so much hype about, oh, funny, you know, Great Nanny Jessie's coming over. So he's at the table, we're eating supper. She's a bit late coming. She comes in, and she's small in stature, right? And she comes in, we say, Great Nanny Jessie's here. And he says, Great Nanny Jessie, you're little. And that's exactly what we did, right? We started laughing. We thought it was so cute and so comical. And as soon as we all started laughing around the table, he said, no, you're not little. You're not little. But she is little. And our laughter sort of guilted him into saying something that wasn't true. And that's an important lesson. You know, we have to be careful what we say. Certainly we do. But we need to speak truth in love. It reminds me of another little boy, this is not mine, who they had new neighbors, and the neighbors came over, and they were all there to meet them in the door. And when they came in, he said, first thing the little boy says, man, you're old. And the parents were, his parents were just, you know, appalled. They said, you apologize right now. And the little boy says, I'm sorry you're old. It's not exactly what the parents were shooting for. But anyways, he did apologize. Children will be children, I guess, right? Kids will be kids. Art Linkletter, right? We must speak the truth in love. The specific words we speak, that'll change. The words we use, they'll change based on our circumstances, based on the situation we find ourselves in. Someone may need hope or peace or guidance or love, but the basis of what we speak, the basis of what we share, the foundation for it must be in the truth that we receive from God. We must speak the truth. And hence this prayer that the psalmist prays. Because as I say later on, and we heard it read, he says, then I'll speak your truth. We'll see it in a second. Then I'll share your truth. But he prays this prayer first. This is what I need in my life. I need to make sure I'm getting things right. Help me to get things right, God. And I'm going to share. If you're there to support that. Because later on in the psalm, he makes a commitment to speak out. But he prays this prayer first. And he expresses this longing to know truth. He shows his convictions about God's principles. And he prays those things. His petition is so genuine. Very genuine. We must speak with conviction. Message says in 1 Corinthians 14, 37 and 39, if any one of you thinks God has something for you to say, or has inspired you to say something, pay attention to what I'm saying. When you speak God's truth, Paul says, speak your heart out. Speak your heart out. If you know it's from God, that should be enough. If God has laid it on your heart, we ought to share it. If it's from God, we certainly ought to share it. Listen to the writer's petition in our psalm. He says, God, teach me lessons for living. God, give me insight. Guide me. Affirm your promises to me. And then I'll be able to stand up to mockery. Listen to why he prays the prayer. God, teach me lessons for living so I can stay the course. Give me insight so I can do what you tell me. Let your love, God, shape my life with salvation exactly as you promised. Then I'll be able to stand up to mockery. He's praying, equip me, prepare me, affirm me so that you can better use me. What a wholesome prayer. What an unselfish prayer this prayer is. And I encourage you all to pray it. Find Psalm 119. You might not have a message translation. I really, really appreciate the words, the paraphrase of Eugene Peterson here. But it's a beautiful portion of that psalm. The whole psalm is nice, but it's really long. Doesn't mean you shouldn't read it, though. Psalm 119. Equip me, prepare me, support me, affirm me, so you can best use me. He says, I'll guard with my life what you reveal to me. The truth, I'll guard it with my life. Guard it now, guard it ever. I'll stride freely through open spaces. Now the NIV here says, I'll walk in freedom, right? I'll walk in freedom, liberated. And I'll stride freely as I look for your truth and your wisdom. Reminds me of the famous words of Jesus where he says, the truth shall set you free, right? He longs for truth, he seeks after truth, and he talks about, I'll stride around freely in open spaces. There's liberty in truth. It's illumination in the darkness. It's clarity of vision. There's freedom in the truth. We sometimes sing the song, Jesus All for Jesus, and the chorus of that says, it's only in your will that I'm free. It's only in your will, Lord, that I'm free. Now that is a paradox to the world, that we can be free being confined to any one person's will. It doesn't make sense to the world. But there's truth in that, that it's only in His will that we're free, because in His will we find for ourselves true purpose and significance and identity. The truth is liberating in that way. Those things are only found when we fully seek God's truth and God's will for our lives. Then after I seek your truth and know your truth, when I know you and follow your lead, then I'll tell the world what I find. Then I'll speak out boldly in public, unembarrassed. Oh, that would be our prayer and our desire as His church and as His people, to get there, to get to that place. And it takes the prayer before it, I think, in our lives. But to get to that place, I'll tell the world what I find, what I found out. I'll speak boldly. If we can only get to where that psalmist was trying to get. By the way, he prayed the prayer. This is his prayer. He was trying to get there himself. And we need to too. It needs to be our striving, our desire. And we can get there. We can know truth and we can share truth. We build it up in ourselves when we come and fellowship and worship together here in this place. When we study God's word, when we pray every day, consistently, it's then we receive and know the truth. And then we ought to pray that God would help us to have a burning desire to speak truth. I encourage you to pray this prayer of the psalmist in 119. We're called to speak out. God isn't silent, and He calls His people to not be silent. God has never been silent. He's only been silent once or twice if He's trying to teach a lesson, but typically He's loud. And sometimes He gets our attention in different ways, but certainly as we read the Bible, He was very loud. Psalm 51:3, again, the message, the God of gods, He speaks out, He shouts. Our God makes His entrance, the psalmist says. He's not shy in His coming. Starbursts of fireworks precede Him, the psalmist says. If we have the truth, if we have a word of hope when someone needs hope, if we have a word of grace when someone needs forgiveness, if we had a word of strength when someone is weak, if we have a word of welcome when someone feels dejected or outcast, we should be sharing those things. And we should be eager to share those things. Proverbs 31:8-9 says, speak up. Speak up for people who have no voice. For the rights of all the down and outers, the message says. Speak out for justice. Stand up for the poor and the destitute. We spent a season doing that. But it goes on past Christmas, right? It may look different, but we keep doing that. We speak up for those who have no voice. We're called not only to speak on God's behalf, but to speak to people, for people's sakes, on behalf of others, to stand in the gap for them. We need to amplify our voices for their sakes. Amplify our voices out of the conviction for the truth, out of the love for the oppressed and the depressed and the dejected, the dispossessed. Let's encourage one another to do that. Let's motivate one another to do that. Let's speak with conviction. If God has given you something, you ought to share it. We spent the whole season talking about how in Jesus God sent us hope and peace and joy and love. And you don't have to do anything but turn on the news or to go walking around your community to see. We live in a world that still desperately, desperately needs those things. And God has called us to share those things and to be those things for people. God may have you in a situation right now where you're able to be one of those things for somebody. All those things. share a word of hope or peace or joy or love with somebody who desperately needs it. God may have placed you in that situation. So we're called to speak truth, to speak for others, to speak with conviction. And finally, we're called to speak out despite our hardship or ridicules. It doesn't always mean we need to use words, right? Speaking up doesn't always require words. Sometimes the situation will call not to speak, actually. I remember sitting with someone who just went through a traumatic experience, and I didn't have the words anyways, and maybe God robbed them from me so I wouldn't speak. And just sat with her. And Kathleen sat with her. And I had to leave and go do other things. Kathleen sat with her all day. That's all we could do in that situation. And we were just at our first appointment, too, so we didn't really have a clue anyways. But it was meant a lot to her. And sometimes we don't have the words. But we have to preach the gospel at all times. When necessary, use words, St. Francis famously said. We're called to do that despite of our circumstances. And sometimes when we feel down, when we feel pressed ourselves, it's harder to share. And yet, I look to the words of Paul, who spoke in sort of all kinds of bad circumstances. And the psalmist that we've been reading from, in Psalm 119, he says, "Teach me lessons for living. Give me insight. Guide me. Affirm your promises. Let your love shape my life. And then I'll stand up to mockery," he says. "Then I'll be unembarrassed. I'll speak boldly." Despite his circumstances. And I go back to Paul from Philippians 1 and 12 up to 14. And I love this portion of Scripture. And it's really good in the Message, paraphrase. I love how the Message even titles it. The title in the Message of that portion is, "They Can't Imprison the Message." They can't imprison the message because Paul's in prison, right? And he's been thrown in prison for what he's been saying and what he's been preaching. And the whole point of this paragraph, the whole point of this portion of Scripture is, yeah, they've imprisoned Paul, but they can't imprison what he's trying to do, who he's speaking for. And here's the words of Paul, Philippians 1:12. This is the Message. "I want to report to you, friends, that my imprisonment has had the opposite effect of its intended effect. Instead of being squelched, the message has actually prospered. All the soldiers here, and everyone else too, found out that I'm in jail because of this Messiah. And that piqued their curiosity. And now they've all learned about him. Not only that, but most of the followers of Jesus here have become far more sure of themselves and their faith than ever, speaking out fearlessly about God and about his Messiah, Jesus." In that terrible situation Paul found himself in, he still spoke out. So often in difficult times, for some of us, for some people, we become even more determined. We gain even more resolve in difficult times. Others are squelched. And I think really it was the presence of this giant of faith, Paul, for the other believers that were there, right? Who gained confidence, who spoke boldly, without fear, even in their situation, even in prison. And I think it was the presence of that giant of faith, Paul, who helped them. And we all need that person. I'm sure most of us can think of someone we look up to. Maybe that person's no longer with us. Maybe they are. But remembering those things that they've done, those things that they've said that have encouraged us, that have given us guidance, call those things to memory. If the person is still with you, think of someone just now. That's a giant in the faith for you that's been just an influence in your life. Maybe you need to go to them for a word if you're discouraged today. If you're in a difficult time today, we need people in our lives like that. And we need each other. We need one another to encourage one another, each other, to motivate each other. Helping each other through difficult times. When we help each other through difficult circumstances, it not only helps our circumstances, but it also helps the message. When we share our story, when we share what God has done for us, when we share where he's brought us from, we don't want to leave out the bad parts. Those are important parts. Because someone else might be going through the exact same thing that we've gone through. And they need to hear that word. You know, if we cut out all the difficult parts of the Bible, if we cut out all the times people were going through bad stuff, we wouldn't have much of a book left. But God has been faithful, and God has been in those situations, and he's in our situations today, and we need to share what he's brought us through. What he's bringing us through, even if we're still going through it, even if we say it and it's still painful. We need to share those things. People need to know. People need to hear. I think of an old song. It goes, I'm going to go to my notes. It's an older song. If I never had a problem, I wouldn't know that God could solve them. I wouldn't know what faith in God could do. If I never had a problem, I wouldn't know that God could solve them. I wouldn't know what faith in God could do. Through it all is the name of the song. Through it all, I've learned to trust in Jesus. I've learned to trust in God. Thank God for his presence and for his moving. I don't know if you're a fan of talking about your story and your journey and sharing it. I don't know if you're a fan of Rick Warren or not, but he does turn out a few good quotes. And he says this, remember how far you've come, not just how far you have to go. You're not where you want to be, no, but neither are you where you used to be. That's an important word for some of us here today, I would say. Remember how far you've come, not just how far you have to go. You are not where you want to be, but neither are where you used to be. And keep heading in that direction, I would add. Keep moving forward. And share where you've been. And share where you are. And share where you're going. Because there's people that need to hear that word. Life is a journey. And now on this, or still early in the new year, our journey has brought us here together in this place. To gain support from others, maybe. To support others, maybe. Probably both. And he's given us a word for this morning. This beautiful prayer from Psalm 119 to help us. We claim those words the same way that the psalmist ends. We'll end this morning. The psalmist in 119 says, these words, your promises, your truth, your precepts. These words, they hold me up in bad times. Your promises rejuvenate me, the message says. This is my comfort in my affliction. Your word has given me life. I pray that you'd find hope, that you'd find peace, you'd find rest if you need that in your life today, whatever you come looking for. I pray whatever you come needing for yourself, whatever you come with on your heart for a loved one, for a family member, for a neighbor, you'd come and you'd search and you'd find it. And then when you do that, you'd share that. Other people would know that. And you'd be that word of comfort and peace and hope for them. May we speak God's truth. May we speak for others. May we speak with conviction and despite our circumstances, about our circumstances. Maybe this morning you've come wanting to hear from God. Maybe you've never accepted yet that simplest truth of the gospel, that Christ died for you, that Jesus saves. There's opportunity for that this morning. If you want to come to the front here and pray, someone will pray with you if you want them to. Well, whatever you come seeking for and longing for this morning, I invite you to pray, whether it's from your seat, whether it's here at the front. I invite you to pray. We're going to sing together. We're going to seek after God, seek after his truth, seek after his will for our lives. We're going to pray for a word from him that we can share, that we can give. I want you to pray that prayer. I want you to take Psalm 119 home, and if it's just these few verses, that's fine. Go through them and pray that prayer. We're going to sing a beautiful chorus. Really, when we look at that prayer, the first part of it, and I need this, Lord, I need your guidance, I need your affirmation, I need your direction. We sing this chorus together. Jesus, be the center. Be my hope. Be my source. Be my light, Jesus. Be the fire in my life, fire in my heart, fire in my spirit. And speak through me and love through me and guide through me and bless through me, Lord. But you be the center. Let's sing it together a few times. This place of prayer is open if you want to come and pray as we sing.